Hey guys, so here we are, held in with the coronavirus. I hope everybody's doing well, and just bear with me the next 2 weeks as we try to get through all of this together. I know I'm not the only one struggling, I'm sure you all are too, so we'll just weather the storm together. This is Owen. You'll probably see him a lot in the videos, so I apologize in advance. He kind of likes to be center of attention. And it's either have him in the video or hear him crying behind the screen. So thank you for understanding. Consider him the child. So we are going to talk a little bit today about the Cask of Amontillado because we really only just finished reading it when we last saw each other. And we didn't get into the real nitty-gritty stuff. I know I mentioned some things while we were reading, but I just wanted to make it a little bit more clear by taking a few minutes to actually talk about the intricacies of the text. So we were going to start with motif, which is a reoccurring symbol in the text, which is, I think, is a definition you guys all learned from Mr. Martelli last year. But in case you don't remember, it's just a gentle reminder. So these can be the reoccurrence of characters, of symbols, ideas, objects, so on and so forth. So some of the biggest motifs that we notice in the Cask of Amontillado is carnival, wine, and the dampness, right? This dampness that Montresor keeps mentioning when they're in the catacombs. So I want to start with carnival because that whole idea of inversion, right? Of things being turned upside down, things being the opposite of what you would expect, which also kind of ties into situational irony to some extent. So carnival plays a huge role in this text, okay? Especially with this idea of opposites. This idea of the dampness, right? It's constantly brought up as Fortunato and Montresor are traveling through the catacombs and the wine cellar. And then the wine, right? That's the whole catalyst of why Fortunato is going into these catacombs with Montresor. Also the fact that Fortunato trust Montresor because supposedly Montresor is his friend, because that's been the facade or the masquerade that Montresor has put on. So even that element of carnival is being shown in the text when he goes from being Fortunato's friend to Fortunato's killer. So we see again that inversion, that swap. Irony. We talked about this a little bit too. So a reminder, we definitely see some verbal irony with Fortunato's name, okay? This idea that his name is Fortunato, it should mean that he's fortunate. Obviously, he's not fortunate because he ends up losing his life at the end of the text. Situational irony. He mentions how he's not going to die of a cough, right? The corona cough. And Montresor says that, no, indeed you won't, okay? Because he knows that he's going to end up killing him. I don't want to say that there's any dramatic irony in the text because we as the readers honestly don't know what Montresor is going to do, right? In fact, a couple of you even asked me in the middle of the reading, what is he doing? We don't know, right? Poe just builds up that suspense as we travel through the vaults with Fortunato and Montresor. And that brings me to narration. So we start off with this first person narration and it continues throughout the text. And Montresor is our narrator. He's our guide through this story, okay? He's our guide through the catacombs. So we as the readers need to rely on Montresor. But is Montresor reliable? We don't even know why he's pursuing Fortunato, right? We don't even know what Fortunato's done. All we know is that to some extent, he has upset, he has hurt Montresor's pride, which we're going to talk about in a little bit. And that is enough for Montresor to go after him and his family crest, which again, we will talk about in a moment. So I want you to think about this question. Is he reliable? Is Montresor reliable? Why or why not? I'm going to skip themes for a second and go into symbols first, because there's a lot of symbols that are going to bring us to these themes. So symbols are going to include Fortunato's clothing, the vault, the trowel, and Montresor's coat of arms and his family motto. So let's start with Fortunato's clothes. So at the beginning, when we're first introduced to Fortunato, he's dressed in motley. Okay, and we talked about that in class. Motley means mixed colors. Okay, he's dressed as a court jester, also known as a fool. So again, we get a little bit of that situational irony because he's dressed up as a fool. It's the inversion from the masquerade, okay? And he ends up being a fool at the end because he foolishly follows Montresor, thinking that Montresor is really his friend and certainly wouldn't do him any harm, right? And the other thing too that makes him the fool, Fortunato, is Montresor warns Fortunato multiple times, right, that he could potentially die if he keeps going into the vault, okay? He doesn't, and Fortunato doesn't heed his advice, okay? He doesn't realize that Montresor is going to kill him, obviously. But even for his own general health, right, he still doesn't socially distance himself from Montresor, okay? So he really is a true fool for not being able to pick up on the hints that Montresor is dropping. Now, in fairness, we go back to this idea of wine, this motif. Throughout the whole entire story, Montresor keeps feeding Fortunato wine, right? He wants him to be drunk so he can get him to the end of the vault and bury him alive. The other thing to notice with the wine, these bottles that Montresor is pulling out, Medoc and de Grava, okay, first off, de Grava spelled grave, okay, a little bit of foreshadowing that it's leading, the de Grava is leading Fortunato to the grave, but those are really good expensive bottles of wine, and if both of those men are connoisseurs, that's not everyday drinking wine they would just be pulling out of the cellar. Okay, so even that is interesting that Montresor is pulling these out to make sure that Fortunato is in that mindset. The vault. So we talked a lot about Gothic literature before we jumped into these short stories, right? And one of the common elements about Gothic literature is that it illustrates that human capacity for evilness, right? Which makes Gothic literature kind of depressing because we don't normally like to look at the negative aspect of human nature, but Poe brings it to the forefront. We've already seen that with The Fall of the House of Usher and The Mask of the Red Death, okay? We really see that with this element of pride, which again, I'll get to in a second. So this vault that Montresor and Fortunato are traveling through, it's the deepest depths of human evilness, right? This bad aspect of our human nature, okay, that they're going further and further into, right? Which even when at the very end, when Montresor realizes what he's done, he's at the pit, okay, of his evilness. He is on the verge of murdering somebody and he starts to feel this guilt, maybe, or it's the dampness, right, of the catacombs. So it also leaves us as readers wondering, does Montresor feel guilty for what he did to Fortunato? He's also not telling this story till 50 years later. But why is he telling this story? Is it cathartic for him to release this story because of his guilt? We don't know. We can only infer. Okay, Montresor's coat of arms. So we talked about the vault, again, that kind of evilness. We talked about Montresor's coat of arms and the family motto. So the coat of arms, remember, is this gold foot stepping on a snake, okay? So the fact that the Montresors believed themselves to be this gold foot obviously shows that they felt pretty highly about themselves, okay? But also, the fact that Montresor has a coat of arms means that he comes from a family that is noble. The motto, right, no one attacks me without impunity, meaning no one attacks me and gets away with it, that is something that's integral to Montresor's family, okay? So obviously this family seeks revenge when they feel like they've been wronged, which again makes us wonder how big of a deal was this problem that or thing that Fortunato did to Montresor. Was it a big thing? Was it a small thing? All we know is that it's happened multiple times. And maybe that's the problem too, that it's too many times that he has crossed the line for Montresor. We also discussed too in class that Montresor mentions that Fortunato is happy, just like he used to be happy. So there's something that's upset Montresor's happiness from Fortunato's actions. But again, we don't know what. And he feels like that Montresor feels as though he is called to uphold his family name, because that is what Montresors do. Okay, they seek revenge. And he's doing a pretty good job of it. And then the trowel, that is the ultimate symbol of revenge, okay? So again, remember, Fortunato identifies the Masons, right? He even does this cool little handshake thing. Montresor kind of looks at him like he's crazy. And then he shows Fortunato that he's carrying a trowel, because that seems normal. And Fortunato thinks that's awesome, right? He's like, oh, so cool. Not thinking that, why is Montresor walking around with a trowel that he's going to use to bury Fortunato alive? So these symbols lead us to our themes. And this is where I'm going to throw it on you, okay? So I want you to think about these theme statements, okay? I'm going to give you some theme words, such as revenge and foolishness and pride, okay? What might Poe be telling us about revenge or foolishness or pride? The other one that I'm going to throw at you guys, too, is masquerade. What might Poe be telling us about masquerade? Because obviously masquerade is going to come from this element of carnival. And obviously Montresor is masquerading as a friend of Fortunato, so on and so forth. So I'm going to have you think about this, okay? What theme do you think is most prevalent in the Cask of Amontillado? Okay, you need to post your theme statement on My St. Mary's. Then you are going to find a piece of evidence from the text that supports that theme statement and explain how that quote supports or illustrates the theme statement. From there, you are going to respond to one of your peers' posts, okay? One that you agree with and one that you disagree with, okay? Now, when I say you agree with that poster, you don't necessarily have to have the same theme. Maybe they bring up another theme that you didn't think of and you're like, oh yeah, that's really brilliant, okay? But you will kindly maybe disagree with somebody else, okay? So that's going to be the theme assignment. If you have any questions or concerns, guys, please reach out, My St. Mary's, email, whatever. I'm here for you guys. And as I said, we'll weather the storm together, okay? I'll see you on my next crash course, if you will. And hopefully you enjoyed the crash course of the Cask of Amontillado. I apologize for my video bomber. At least it's only one today. I'll see you guys soon. Be safe out there.